People are worried about privacy. One day, someone revealed that a government was secretly screening everyone's messages. The people felt their privacy was violated. The government felt its privacy was violated, because they really didn't want you to know they were spying on you. Boy, were they mad. The powers that be wish to see what you're doing without being seen. Meanwhile, the people wish the powers were more transparent, but they don't like being spied on themselves. So there is this mutual desire for one's own opacity and the other's transparency. Secrecy for us, openness for them. As long as people desire power over each other, we have this eternal conflict between the powers that be and the powers that wish to be. Each side wants to tear down the other's walls. If you have better intelligence on your opponent than he has on you, that gives you a strategic advantage in the game, if you're playing a game. Maybe even an unfair advantage, depending on how you look at things. Privacy equates to secrecy. And for millions of people on the internet, the key to secrecy is anonymity. One example, political activists face a real risk of harm from their opponents should their true identities be revealed. So they use a phony name and wear a mask to try to protect themselves from harm. Now hang on to that word, because in fact harm is the problem here, not information. The danger isn't what someone knows about you. The danger is that they might hurt you. Not that I can crack your bank account, but that I might steal from it. People hurting each other is the problem, not the intelligence. Let's try to keep that in mind. But having faith in the badness of others, we still think hiding will save us. That's folly. For one thing, hiding only works for a while, and then they find you. For another thing, the expectation of evil was never a good excuse to become evil, and it still isn't. The trick is to always let evil be somebody else's job. A state claims the right to secrecy in the name of protecting you from harm by your enemies. Which enemies? Well, the tradition is that you and your government are on one side, and the bad guys and their government are on the other side. And some people still believe in that. But it's not that simple anymore. Your government can't share its secrets with you because that would expose them to the opponent, who may be across the world, or sitting beside you in the cafe. That means you must be treated with the same suspicion as if you were the opponent. Functionally, you are the enemy of the state. And the more you wish to know their secrets, the more of an enemy you become. Of course, you can also turn the game board sideways and show that the real conflict is all the people versus all the powers. In reality, the struggle for liberation has always been one thing. The powers don't like it when you think like that, but you can. Anonymity may be a tool for the noble activist, but it's also a tool for the common vandal. And that's where things get confusing, because anonymity is also the engine behind all the worst abominations of the digital world. Spamming, scamming, trolling, and the impenetrable silence of corporations who want to manipulate you without getting caught. All those things require a mechanism for doing stuff without naming yourself. Action without authorship. That's what anonymity is. You may have noticed a lot of people enjoy being nasty online. I guess it gives them a power kick in a time of impotence. To me, this is another face of gamification, because hurting is a form of winning. We play games on the computer, sometimes with each other's feelings. We can do this because, on the internet, nobody knows you're 12. They don't know if you're really a porn star, a drug dealer, an FBI agent, or Her Majesty the Queen. In real life, you can be one person, and online, you can be another. Being simultaneously two or more people means you can get away with saying nasty things to strangers, for a while. But it also means you're fragmenting. You're volunteering for multiple personality disorder. Personally, I don't think that's good for your soul. In this life, it's hard enough to keep your integrity. Why choose to disintegrate? Unless you tell them, nobody knows who you really are. And to really be somebody is necessary. To say what you mean, put your name on it, take the shit for it, and stand behind it, or back down when you're wrong. That's what being human is. And believe it or not, you can do that in the digital world. You can be human in public. There was once a political activist who kept no secrets. He publicly announced every move he was going to make. He made the moves he promised. He tried to do the right thing, and whenever he found he was wrong, he was openly contrite about it. The powers that be regularly jailed him for sedition. He faced a lot of trouble, but his policy of being honest served him pretty well. You could say he got away with that openness because he was famous. But how did he get famous? By using his real name. I think in our time, privacy is over. Life is porous. It's full of holes. Everything is permeable now. Governments and corporations collect info about us, and then somebody leaks the info, and it's everywhere. Privacy is finished. Secrecy is obsolete. How do we want to handle that? I think the trick is to be one person. Be integral. Do the things you don't mind signing your name to, and then sign the things you do. Be the author of your actions. I should probably continue to close the toilet door and shut the curtains to the bedroom, but I shouldn't delude myself that I can ever keep any real secrets from the world. I might as well get used to that. At least that's what I think.